what on earth kind of possessed you to suddenly decide to build a house?
I think it was a sort of fantastical dream, and I thought, I'm just going to see if this is possible.
I came to this country to travel, essentially. I didn't expect to meet someone, fall in love, get married and build a house.
Idea of a prefab building, maybe something like this. But the instant home now comes in all shapes and sizes, like convenience foods. These are convenience houses, and some of the more high-tech elements, like these bathrooms, are being used more and more on cutting-edge builds. This week, I'm meeting a couple of newlyweds, Jane and Willem, who are convinced that a ready-made home is the shortcut to their 21st century dream, a dream which was bought and designed on the internet. And where else is this 21st century email-designed house being built but in the heart of West Sussex? So how on earth did you find this site?
I was looking for derelict property. I decided that was the only way I was going to find a countryside plot, and it came from a local estate agency.
So what, you pulled the finance together just like that?
Money came from, yeah, big mortgage, frightening mortgage, and also I write books, so there was a deposit from a book that I'd written, which was the...
So you had a bit of cash lump sum you could donate?
Yeah.
So when did you buy this place?
It was just over 2.5 years ago.
Right, and you've recently got married?
Yes, in August
this year. So you bought this as a single woman?
I did. Crazy dream. Fortunately, I've now found the right person to share it with.
You were in your mid-20s then, 3 years ago. I mean, what on earth kind of possessed you to suddenly decide to build a house at that age?
I think it was a sort of fantastical dream. I'd done a couple of loft interiors in a loft development in London, and I love the drama of expressing yourself in internal space. And it had sort of grown from that, and I thought, wouldn't it be fantastic if you could just create your entire nest inside and outside.
Yeah.
And I thought, I'm just going to see if this is possible.
The plan is to demolish this 70s chalet and replace it with a brand new house that Jane is ordering from America. The house is being prefabricated in Boston by American kit house company Acorn and Deck House. Jane's been able to keep in touch with the design using the internet. She was already a year into her project when she met her husband Willem. Does this feel as though it's going to be your home?
Absolutely.
Do you feel as though you've had an input?
Absolutely. I mean, it was a little tricky in the first case because she had established relationships with the builders and the architects and so on.
Yeah.
She also has more time to deal with the project.
Yeah.
But emotionally, I'm connected to it.
So tell me about the house you're going to build. It's not this bungalow, is it?
It's not, no. It's an American-style house. It's open plan, quite a lot of double height space. A lot of quite dramatic, sort of glamorous internal architecture.
Yeah, and this is all in the middle of West Sussex. I mean, there's some lovely little cottages around here, but nothing like that.
Nothing like that, no, it's true. But I think it's a well-sheltered site, and I think if you can't build a bit of slightly dramatic architecture in a one-off, sheltered, semi-rural location, then, I mean, where can you?
Yeah. What's it going to look like?
I can
it's all in
look.
Here.
Yeah, it's all in here, and I made a model.
And it's there. Under this hat.
Under this hat lurks the house. There's the inside.
You're outrageous. Look at that. This you put the carpet in and pot plant.
We as
well.
When I was making it, I began to realise just what a volume of space this was.
It's like a sort of big internal climbing frame.
Yeah.
And what's this area here?
Actually, the deck is a new addition. We received a rather generous sum of money from my father as a wedding gift.
Really?
And immediately I thought, I know exactly where to spend that.
So it is very much an American home you're going to have. Are you hoping that you're going to feel as though you're in America?
Well, it was one of the first places I ever traveled to was New England, and I fell in love with the architecture about 10 years ago.
Jane's house will have trademark New England features like timber decking, painted cedarwood cladding, and oversized windows. Built into the sloping site, the living area features a vast double-height ceiling with views across the North Downs. As it leads down into the dining room, the space opens out to an American-style open-plan kitchen. Rather than cramming in individual rooms, Jane's gone for all-out luxury, with split levels and generous proportions throughout.
Above the spare bedroom, Jane's planned an indulgence suite, complete with walk-in wardrobe, master bedroom and a spa-like bathroom decorated in thousands of Moroccan tiles trawled from a recent trip to Marrakesh. A spiral staircase leads up to the galleried study, a crow's nest which overlooks both the entire house and the views beyond.
You must be running pretty tight, aren't you, building a house this generous, this big, is it?
Yeah.
Money must be an issue, yeah?
Yeah, it has been. The sort of project amount we've got is about 250.
That's the total build, is it?
That's including land.
Including the land?
Land was 100,
okay.
So that was a big whack.
With the bungalow on it, okay.
Yeah,
and what's your contingency?
It's about 10%.
And where are you going to be living while you're building this?
We're going to be staying in a flat in London.
So what's the deadline for this wonderful fantasy?
Well, we're hoping next August to have a party which will celebrate 1 year of being married. There may be no paint on the walls, but...
There'll be a roof on.
There will be a roof on. Oh, God, I hope so.
Jane bought her plot 2 years ago for £100,000. The kit costs £60,000 and construction will be another £50,000. She's also set aside £40,000 for fitting out the interior, making a total of £250,000.
As you would imagine, finding a virgin plot of land in the middle of the English countryside to build on is almost impossible. Now, what Jane's done is buy a plot on which there was already a building, a bungalow. Now, the trouble with that is that you pay for it three times. You pay for the land, you pay for the bungalow that you don't want, and you also pay for the demolition. And that's what's going to happen today.
Today, the adventure begins. And Jane's on her own.
Willem, unfortunately, is working on a project that has to be delivered at lunchtime, so of all the days, this was the day he couldn't take off. There was no option. It took 2.5 years to get to where we are today. There was delays of planning, just a question of coaxing the planners into what we wanted to do. But at last, 2.5 years later, it's all gone and we have a view. It's almost slightly surreal, the fact that at last it's been such a virtual dream for so long, and now there's real rubble and machinery and noise and chaos. Today really feels like the beginning. I see the finished house, I take walks around it in my imagination, but today other people can see what we're preparing for so long. It's been carried around in people's heads, and all of a sudden it's real.
Importing a house from America calls for strict scheduling. The kit's arriving in exactly 5 weeks. The man responsible for ensuring everything's ready in time is local builder Chris Marchant-Lane.
My role on the site is to organise the trades that will come in to construct the house. In my 25-year career as a builder, I've never actually put up a timber frame house. It's going to be an interesting experience. Learn something new.
Kit houses are prefabricated in factories. The walls are made in sections out of basic softwood frames. All the dimensions of the panels are all set by computer. The frames are then cut to size, nailed together, and then strengthened with a skin of rigid board made from wood pulp. Even doors and windows can be pre-inserted into the walls. This way, an entire house can leave in one container. And Jane's container is now on the high seas. There's no changing the delivery date now. Chris has just 3 weeks to clear the site and lay foundations. But our English weather isn't helping.
On the Friday we started to dig, it rained at lunchtime, torrential rain, and that put paid to that day's work, and the trenches we'd dug caved in, filled up with water. Saturday we came back to continue the excavation and weren't able to because the site was still too wet. Since then we've been lucky, it's been dry weather, and we've been able to get on with it.
The timber kit gets fixed onto a flat concrete raft, which in turn sits on these concrete footings. Getting them poured is Chris's first milestone.
This is what they call a bottoming out party.
But it's something of a hollow victory. Chris has got 1 week to get everything ready before the kit's arrival. There's still drains to install, retaining walls to build, and the concrete plinth to pour.
I have a deadline, which I'll try and meet, and if I can't, you've given it your best shot. And we're going to work Saturday and Sunday.
The ship docks at Felixstowe. And a mere 24 hours before the kit arrives on site, the concrete is barely hard. But Chris can relax. The Americans are coming.
The American coming over to assist us with the construction is a good thing. He'll be here to assist us in the main construction of the house. So that would be the wall panels, flooring, and the roof. Once he's done that, then we're perfectly capable of putting the rest together.
This is the Boston Company's first project in the UK. They're sending in two of their most experienced men, Jim Cram and Peter King. Peter's taught local teams of builders the American way of putting up houses in Japan, Argentina, and Korea. Now it's Britain's turn.
Incredibly moved, actually. It's like a very significant realization of a rather fantastical dream. It's kind of unremarkable on the outside and sort of what it represents internally. It's like a sort of nest arriving on wheels. I sort of never thought it wouldn't come, but I can't really believe it's here. Imagining it for so long.
Everything they'll need to build their house is contained in these two 40-foot lorry loads. Wall panels, window sections, doors, stairs, cladding, even a giant tin of paint. Even with the Americans' expert direction and all hands on site, it'll take the best part of the day to unpack the kit. Every piece of this 3D jigsaw is numbered, and it's vital they're stacked in the order that they'll be assembled. But as night falls, they're still unloading. In fact, it's well into the night before they can say goodbye to the lorry.
So, 3 years after Jane found the site, the great day has finally come. The house arrived yesterday on the back of a lorry, and the guy spent all night unloading it. And today, they're going to start building it out of these 6,000 pieces of wood.
Under the Americans' direction, Chris's men start putting the kit together. First to go up are the corner sections.
Having sort of cut out the model and seen the drawings, what's it like seeing it in the flesh?
It's absolutely incredibly surreal and extraordinary and wonderful. Amazing day. Yeah.
It's going up so quickly.
We went off to lunch, and when we came back, the whole kitchen was there.
Have you had any sleepless nights over it? Is there anything that worries you terribly about it all?
My worry has gone, which was concerns about just getting everything in time for the kit turning up.
Yeah.
So in a sense, now that we're over that hurdle, I think the sleepless nights will probably abate a bit. Mm.
So, are you meant to be putting the kitchen up?
Well, I'm avoiding heavy lifting today, actually.
Why?
We moved so much stuff yesterday.
But you are, aren't you? You're sort of getting involved.
That's
the idea, at least.
Being involved in constructing the house as much as I can is important to me because I was left out of the loop. You know, Jane went so far with this project before she met me, and we were engaged and married. So actually being hands-on in the construction is important.
But in terms of the overall build, I mean, you know, I suppose you could say, you know, the house is Jane's conception.
Yeah.
So which bit of it is yours? Which bit of it do you feel you're able to appropriate?
The kitchen is mine.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, you designed that?
Well, I'm the cook. And so I need to design my own space.
Yeah. Now, you've got the flat in London, yeah?
Yeah.
Which you're going to keep. So mm-hmm. this is going to be kind of a weekend retreat, or do you see it becoming a permanent home?
Full-time
home?
I do.
Do you?
Yeah, we both do. This is a home for life. We'll be raising children here. We'll be living here. Yeah, absolutely.
Jim, what's your job here?
I'm the export manager at Deckhouse.
Right. So what does that mean?
Well, we're located outside of Boston, and we build houses and ship them all over the United States, and I'm the one responsible for shipping them outside of the United States.
Okay. How do you get away with putting up an American building in the middle of Sussex?
Well, it wasn't too far into this project that I learned about planning, and I learned that planning is a very real thing in the UK.
And what about things like, I don't know, American weatherboarding and typical details, roofs, that kind of thing. Right. Have you had to change those?
The weatherboarding we're going to stick with, and we have permission for that. But the roof was something that definitely had to be changed, and we're going to use a local English tile.
So what about schedule? When's it going to be ready then?
We think our part will be done in just 2.5 to 3 weeks. We should have the shell up. Yeah. A week after that, we'd like to see the roof on, so it's on and weathertight in just a 4-week period of time.
Which would be by Christmas.
Christmas would be good.
Jim can afford to be confident. He's going home in 2 days, but Peter's got to stay and show the British builders how to put the kit together.
How does a building like this work then? You've got a big concrete plinth to begin with, but how do you put the walls up?
Well, it's a panelized system. Each of these wall sections come in 4-foot sections, mostly 4-foot sections, some in 2-foot sections, with windows already installed.
Dead easy. And they're quite short. I mean, they're quite small, so you can manhandle them
easily.
Yeah,
some of them are. These are the shorter ones. We have some very tall ones, which are going to be a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, is it normal for you to do this kind of thing, for somebody to come over and spend this amount of time on a project abroad?
Yeah, Acorn almost always sends someone over to a foreign site, because people have different habits in how they approach a building project.
What's it like working then with British builders?
Well, it's very nice. We can speak the same language, so we have one thing in common.
Well, I hope it's not the only thing they have in common. British chippies don't even seem to use the same tools.
Now, you may be wondering why a timber building like this doesn't just get blown away in the wind, and the answer is this. It's the builder's equivalent of the AK-47, and does this. Straight into the concrete. And this lot are leaving nothing to chance. The Americans are even bringing their own nails.
However, Peter's nail gun is the only one on site. The British carpenter's lack of experience with timber construction is showing.
The crew here isn't as set up for timber framing or stud framing as an American crew would be, so we don't have very many air tools. We don't have any pneumatic guns, which would be very common. I mean, no builder would drive a nail by hand in the States if they could avoid it.
In the next 3 weeks, Peter's aiming to have the entire shell of the house up, as well as training the British carpenters. I think that's a tall order.
It's moved a little bit slower than I would have liked to have it move, and that's just because there's fewer people and fewer carpenters than I usually work with. But we're making good progress, and it's coming along pretty well.
Peter's obviously a good teacher. The ground floor takes 10 days, but the second level goes up in only 3. Tom is the main carpenter on site. He'll take over when Peter leaves. In all, the timber frame takes just 3 weeks to erect. Compared to more conventional building methods, that may seem very quick, but it's taken a week longer than the Americans predicted. And there's still the roof, doors, and external cladding to go on. The roof alone is taking twice as long as expected.
This is Monday, and I'm leaving on Friday. If it's not done then, Tom gets to finish it.
It's just like a great big studwork house with ply on the front. It's a lot easier because everything, all the panels are numbered, and you just put them all together in the right order and make sure they're level.
Well, Peter didn't meet his deadline. and it takes Tom another week to finish the roof trusses and complete the framework.
It does look as though they will be here for their first wedding anniversary next year, but with the Americans safely home, with the British winter to come, and with British contractors lined up, who knows, the worst may be yet to come. Interesting times ahead.
It's 6 weeks since construction of Jane and Willem's kit house began. The Americans have now left, and it's up to the British to carry the project through to completion.
Goodness. Well, that's extraordinary. So the Americans delivered their promise. I mean, they put you up a house.
How?
When did they go?
Went. Yeah. Peter left a week and a half ago.
And has it all collapsed into confusion since then?
No.
Are there things that you've changed, as it were? Or
we're putting in a few extra windows that we sort of ruled out to save some money. They're on the plan, but we've decided to put them back in.
Yeah.
Here, 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 and here. Four windows, which means when you come in on the entry level, you immediately get these four framed pictures of the view.
Yeah.
So we're going to put them back in again.
And putting all these things back, the windows and so forth, has that changed the budget? Has it been you're spending...
Yes, we are obviously spending a bit more. The extra windows have cost about £1,000, and in a project that's really stretched us, it just didn't seem something worth economising on.
But you haven't met a British electrician or plumber yet, have you?
We've got a big lump set aside for British services.
Building this American house in Sussex may be a first-time experience for everyone involved, but prefab construction has been around for a while. One of its earliest incarnations was as post-war emergency housing.
We moved in on the 10th of December 1946.
And we were absolutely thrilled with it.
I will never leave here unless I'm forced to. They would have to carry me out.
I love it. I wouldn't swap it for Buckingham Palace, even if they included the Queen.
Prefab is now the fashionable choice, and it's come a long way since the humble wartime bungalow. Nowadays, most new builds incorporate some prefab components. Timber wall panels, for example, which are in virtually every new home. And the more exciting ones even have funky clip-on bathrooms. If you're going to self-build, I can't think of a quicker way to do it.
This high-spec bathroom pod, for example, is simply craned into position and plugged into the services on site. Abroad, the prefab industry is booming. In Japan, houses are usually built in factories, but they're tailored to individual specifications, which you can order in showrooms. Scandinavia rolls out ecologically sound houses in industrial-scale production lines. While the Netherlands produce entire streets in days, teams of builders construct prefabricated shells and the roofs are craned in to unfold into position. In the States, nearly all new builds use prefabricated materials, from entire wall panels to entire house shells. The prospect of importing a ready-made home is now a viable reality. But buying a house from a company 3,000 miles away isn't entirely straightforward. Local planning restrictions have meant Jane isn't able to use the flexible wooden American shingles the roof was designed for. The British tiles she's chosen are rigid, and they have to interlock precisely.
The tiles don't fit like they're supposed to fit. And we've had to pack them up, and they had to jiggle them about all over the place, top and bottom, side to side. But it's going on. They're going on, but very slowly. Slower than we expected.
Jane's agreed a fixed price deal with the roofers. So no matter how long the job takes, she won't be losing money.
Let's put it this way. It should have taken us just under 20 days, and we were 43 days.
Yeah.
And we still haven't quite finished yet. There's nothing wrong with the product, it's just the roof was not the right roof for the tiles.
Jane, I want to talk long and hard about this roof, which I'm sure you love.
Yes, I do.
The tiler said that this was horrific to put on because...
It turns out that he did have some difficulties.
Yeah, so who spec'd this roof then?
Well, in fact, we talked it through with them. But it was just, I think it's a new product. I mean, I love it because it was affordable and it's a clay tile. And I never thought that I'd ever end up with a clay tile on it.
But it's the colour of slate.
It is.
Why have you gone for grey? Why not go for the local vernacular dark brown, dark reddish colour?
I think the whole project is not about vernacular.
It's not Sussex vernacular. On the other hand, it isn't American.
And it's not trying to be.
No.
And nor is it trying to be completely American. Yeah, it's its own thing. And I think this works for me with the cedar.
Because it's built into a sloping site, the whole house isn't fully visible from the road. But what you do see from the road is the roof covered in black clay tiles that ironically look like they might be concrete.
It's a surreal thought, but 4 months ago, this house already existed, but only in a virtual reality. It was designed on the web. And maybe it's because of that. Maybe it's because of the quality of the graphics packages on computers. Or maybe it's just because it's an American house. But to my mind, it just looks odd here.
With the roof finally tiled and the framework wrapped, all that's left to do externally is clad the house in the distinctive New England painted weatherboarding. The interior is just beginning to take shape. Chris can't afford to slow down. Like the roofers, he's on a fixed price deal, so any overrun means he'll be out of pocket. The pressure's on Jane too. With a project that moves as fast as this, she's got her work cut out, choosing and ordering all the interior fixtures and fittings.
Thank you very much. Okay, bye-bye.
It's March now, and it's just 4 months since Jane and Willem saw their honeymoon project arrive on the back of that lorry. And already, their dream kit house is watertight. At a time when most self-build projects are still lurching from one disaster to the next. Now, the builder's own schedule gives them just 4 weeks to get the whole project completed and all but habitable, which means that it won't be very long before the happy couple are stepping over the threshold.
Great.
This is very, very different to when I saw it last. You've got stairs in.
We have stairs and we have edges. It's no longer an X-ray house. You still have ceiling.
Yeah, you have a roof as well, which is a big difference. And plasterboard.
It's all happening.
Looking this way.
Yes.
All this wood, and all this detailing. I mean, I remember you saying you wanted to have this big view.
I wouldn't have wanted to have a big glass wall because I think once it's finished, this is going to seem like a big expanse of glass as it is. Mm. It works for me.
It is your home, after all, not mine.
Upstairs?
This is the bathroom.
This is.
Lovely high ceiling. And what's this?
This is an indulgence.
What? It's a big tub.
Big double bathtub.
Big double bathtub.
Yeah,
not my colour, dark blue.
Oh, I love it. I think a big white bath would have looked like a mortuary.
With this?
yes.
It's not a shower head, is it? That looks like a garden sieve. On a scale to equal the bath, really. In a way, the bathroom is sort of on the scale with the house, and the whole house is a kind of a large statement, isn't it? It's kind of quite assertive. And
Yes. I think if you're going to do something like build a house, you have to invest your personality in it and express yourself.
Does the house really, truly reflect your personality?
It feels fantastic. I mean, it feels sort of even better than I could have imagined. And it was interesting. Last weekend, we were here, and it really began to feel not so much like an architectural experiment or a house, but like my home, like our home. And it really works.
Everything you say about it tells me about your personality, but does Willem figure?
This is us. It's the internal space that you create together that becomes your shared home.
So has building a house turned you into a different woman? I mean, has it empowered you?
It has empowered me. It's made me realise that I can manage a project like this, in a sense. 3 years ago, I would never have imagined I would be so organised. I used to be chaotic and cluttered. And now I'm quite organised and I have flowcharts and, you know.
When I first met Will and Jane, they described this as their honeymoon project, something that they would want to do together, even though it did originally start out just as Jane's idea. And yet, I never get to see Willem. I mean, he must have been here once in all the time that I visited the site. So whose project is it? I mean, is it still Jane's baby? And how does Willem feel about it? Willem's got a full-time job up in London, working as a graphic artist for a website design firm. So how does he keep in touch?
I get updates from her. I sort of get download sessions when I get home.
What do you discuss? What do you talk about?
I mean, every aspect of the build. I come home and we talk house and we get all the issues sorted out and we make calls if we need to and so on. And then it's like, that's over. And we can just sort of relax and be husband and wife. Jane's like carrying this house.
Like she would carry a
child. Like she would carry a child. And I have the traditionally fatherly role in that I am fairly detached.
I mean, is it your dream, though? I mean, as much as it is hers, it's clearly something that she's passionately wanted and felt.
Obviously not.
Well, what is then? What is it?
What is? I came to this country to travel, essentially, I guess.
Yeah.
I didn't expect to meet someone, fall in love, get married and build a house. Certainly not.
But are you happy with it?
Absolutely.
The build is now running 4 weeks behind schedule. The longer Chris remains on site, the more money he loses.
So, has it gone well? I mean, are you pleased with the build so far?
Well, the only thing I'm not happy with is the information I was given by the Americans in the time it would take to put the kit up. It's probably taken another 8 weeks beyond what they indicated, even me allowing for it taking longer than that.
Right. Who's paying for the extra time that it took to put up the kit in the first place?
In short, I am, because I had a contract price with Jane to put the kit up.
Right.
So any overrun is down to me.
Has that hurt a lot?
It is at the moment, yes, but it's nothing I can't manage. You know, I'll get over it. And
you just swallow this as a part of your professional...
Yeah. It's just a learning
pattern
curve.
Of life.
Yes, absolutely. Well put.
So, what else have you got to do?
I have to waterproof the front walls. I have to build a chimney. I have to finish the plastering, the bulk of which should be done this week.
Yeah.
Tidy the backfill site, make two drain connections, and put the guttering up.
Right.
And then I'm finished, and I'll be out of here in a month.
Perhaps it's not surprising this project is late. It's a pioneering American build, of which Chris naturally had no previous experience. But the end's in sight for him. After he leaves, it'll be entirely down to Jane and Willem to finish their house. It's now 6 months since this project started, and Chris is still building. He's been here 8 weeks longer than he scheduled, and don't forget, he's on a fixed price deal. And yet I thought, the point about kit houses is that they're supposed to go up quickly. So what's gone wrong?
The frame has been much more complicated to do and much more time-consuming than we were led to believe originally. The Americans seem to have this great enthusiasm for these buildings, and they sort of said they could wind it up from start to finish in 4 weeks, and I've since discovered that that's just to put the external frame up. That's not to do all the other bits and pieces that go with it.
Jane's devised a cunning method of mixing plaster with paint pigment. This way, the vast walls will be coloured as they're plastered, saving Jane and Chris time and money, at least in theory. The drawback with this method is that you get beautifully finished surfaces, but before the builders leave. But leave they do, and the finishing is now purely in Jane and Willem's hands. Now at last, Willem's getting really stuck in. He's even building the central feature of the living room, a fireplace he's designed himself. And he's using his graphic skills to design a pattern for the bathroom tiles, which they bought in Morocco.
We were on holiday in Marrakesh about a year ago, and what they actually do to make these intricate mosaic tiles is they just obviously bake full-size ones, and they then chisel them up. And we thought we saw these and thought they were absolutely fantastic and that we could use them full-size. So we imported, I think, about 2,500 of them, 20p each. Something similar here would be probably close to about £2.
But perhaps there's a reason why they're only 20p.
There's a big selection process in that quite a lot of them, as a handmade, are just too messy to use. At the last minute, Jane has decided she doesn't like the red tile particularly. And as the shower was going to be basically red, yellow and green, we've had to make a lot of amendments. Obviously, I can't nip back to Marrakesh and top up the tile stock.
Jane's also saving on bathroom fitting.
To get the copper.
She's bought some cheap brass taps and lights and is having them copper plated so they'll look expensive.
By buying these sort of discounted fittings, we've ended up saving probably in the order of about £500, because taps are incredibly expensive. I had no idea.
And another inexpensive option is a flat pack kitchen for their flat pack home, which of course takes almost as long to construct as the entire house. But outside, the house still isn't finished. There's one classic American feature to add, the decking, which is a present from Willem's father in New Zealand.
So where's your decking going to go? Is it just here?
It is, it's here.
Is this it, here? No.
No, too noisy.
It's huge.
I think this will be a project in several stages.
OK. Stage one is?
Stage one is the decking.
Right.
As that was our wedding present.
Yes.
And we've actually got the wood sitting
out
there.
That is going to happen, isn't it?
That is really going to happen. Yes. And then the sort of project works this way down the garden.
Into this sort of wilderness of beautiful...
railway sleeper sort of walks around.
And ponds and water. So what's the cost of all this, the decking and...?
We've basically got £5,000 at the moment to spend on landscaping, which is not going to buy us a fraction of this. And I think we'll do lots of that ourselves if we sort of... I think we'll have to.
The decking goes up in a couple of days, and it inspires them to raid their cash reserves for the garden.
We always had a contingency in the budget, but it was always on our minds we would use it for furniture. That was it, we were going to use it for furniture if it was left. And then we just got completely carried away out here, and we thought, can we always get furniture?
So, the digger returns to site to do some major landscaping and build some terraces.
So we're onto the fun stuff now.
There's a week to go before their first wedding anniversary, and Jane and Willem are putting all their energy into getting the house finished by then.
And we're both completely exhausted, which is to be expected. I can hardly speak. The party does feel like an additional pressure, but it's a galvanising pressure. It kind of gives that last bit of momentum.
It's been a year since the crack American team descended on this sleepy Sussex village with their email-designed kit house. But for the last 3 months, Willem and Jane have been working alone on the project. Frankly, it's only because of their commitment and their passion about it that they've got the thing finished in time for their first wedding anniversary. So, their marriage has held together. Let's see if the house does. Hiya.
Hi, Kevin.
Jane, how are you?
Very well.
Yeah?
Yes.
You sound a bit croaky.
I'm a bit croaky.
Oh, wow. Everything all mixed together.
That's a very personal statement.
Yeah, but you are really finished, aren't you? It's all exactly like the model. I can't believe it.
More or less.
Will, how are you? All right?
Yeah, how are you?
Great. Well, this is your kitchen.
Yeah.
This is all new. I haven't seen any of this before. Because it works very well here, you know?
Yeah.
This is a great success. It's been this big double window.
Brings so much light in.
And the floor is great. Is this marble?
Underfloor heater. Can you feel the warmth?
I can't believe it. And you've got that throughout the house,
haven't
you?
Yeah.
What are you most proud of here?
Well, I just think the layout, actually. You know, it's got that natural triangle between the sink and the fridge, and that, you know, the magic cooking
triangle. The cooker, fridge,
yeah,
sink.
And you just revolves at high speed, exactly. I think
the kitchen's a great success.
Yeah.
What else is you in the house?
Well, what's extremely me is that big fireplace over there.
Yeah, I did clock that when we came in. Oh yeah. Do you know, I really like this. I think it's great.
I'm glad you do.
It's kind of big, groovy, organic in South America.
It's had very mixed reactions, this.
I bet it has. Yeah. It's not to everybody's taste,
especially
is it?
Since it went purple.
Yeah, and particularly since it's probably the size of most people's living rooms. Yeah. Anyway.
It's holding up the wall. I think it's pushing the wall out.
The other major piece of furniture is
it's
this
daybed.
Yeah.
It's not really a daybed, is it? It's more like a sort of grown-up playground, you know?
It is.
I think of it as a kind of romper area. So this is the guest bedroom, isn't it, in here?
It is, yeah.
Through the stained glass door.
We're using it as a meditation room.
Yeah, great.
Escape
from everything. Well, that's why you come down here. This looks nice. This kind
it's of, more contemporary.
Yeah. It's beautiful, isn't it?
Tumbled.
Very nice little bathroom. And up.
You want to come to the indulgence zone.
Indulgence zone. Everything in this house is an indulgence zone. Blimey. What a full-on room.
Yeah.
It's a strong statement of individualism.
Yeah, you said it in one. With a fantastic view. But this bath, you know, now the tiles are in, I have to say it, it's a bit better, isn't it?
Yeah.
But this is a triumph. Where did you get these bowls from?
Bowls are from Morocco. Chinese sideboard from a junk shop.
Mirror from Venice, and you've had this coppered. Now, the shower, which was just a box when I saw it last, is... Yeah. I think that is a triumph.
More
that
proper.
Is beautiful.
Yeah,
and what's that shower like? Look at it. Oh, look at the water.
It's beautiful,
rippling
isn't
on
it?
The copper. Yeah, what a beautiful. Great, great thing. Talk about indulgence, eh? Of every kind. And this is Moroccan. It's Chinese, it's English, bit of Venetian thrown in.
It's American.
Egyptian, American.
Yeah.
But that's the whole thing about doing something like this. You can just pull together all the things you like.
There you go. Through the Mughal doors, it's into a Mughal bedroom. Whoa! Great bed, beautiful cover, isn't it? Mm. And that lovely wall hanging above it. And I thought the sitting room was red.
I just love sleeping in this kind of colour. It was really pale to begin with, and I couldn't sleep properly.
Yeah.
I was a dictator about that, wasn't I? Yep.
Where do you get dressed? Where do you wear all your
We
things?
Wanted to keep this really empty so that you really can switch off, and we've got a walk-in wardrobe or closet.
Oh, through here?
Yeah.
It's vast! I mean, you could live in here. It's a complete room.
Yeah, well, one of us has got rather a lot of clothes.
One of us has got rather a lot of shoes.
Yeah
well, one of us has got rather a lot of everything, actually. Fantastic view, isn't it? I keep coming back to that.
It is. I can't ever stop looking at it.
What an extraordinary place to build a house.
It's a view to die for.
Absolutely. And you've also got a view into the building as well, haven't you? From here?
But the big surprise of the house has been just how high up you are. I just didn't have any conception of just how big the volume was going to be until the floors began to go in.
Well, look, congratulations, because, you know, very few people meet their deadlines.
Yeah.
So, now, look, to be perfectly blunt about this, how much does the whole thing cost you?
It's cost about $265,270.
And how much have you spent over your original budget?
We've spent about 20 more.
Where did the money come from?
I did a book this year and I'm just about to do another one. So the sort of money that's come in...
In one pocket.
And out the other. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
What next?
I feel like there's been three of us in this marriage. The house has been the Camilla Parker Bowles of our relationship in the last 12 months. I feel for so long it's been borrowing more of me than I really want to give it for longer than the project takes. So it'll just be great to actually learn to live in the space.
Lots of money.
You were very, very feisty to take it on and design it over the net and do all the things you did.
I think it's partly not really appreciating quite the enormity of what you're taking on is why people can dream big, shiny dreams. You probably wouldn't be so eager to get into it if you're a real pragmatist.
Mm-hmm. And has it cemented your relationship?
Yeah. It's been like a sort of... I mean, for me, it's been a question of renegotiating the dream and waiting for that moment when Will would seize it and feel as involved as I, and I couldn't wait for that moment.
I had to run to catch up, but once I caught up and caught on, I was with the project. It's, you know, it's got my blood and sweat and tears literally in this building, and it's our place, completely and utterly.
When I first met Jane, I thought to myself, here is a woman who is pushing herself beyond the limit, who's buying a kit house in a box that's going to look like something from Legoland in the middle of the Sussex countryside, and who is building her vision, her way, despite her new and very much loved husband. But I have been trumped. Now that the landscaping's finished, this house actually looks better than many I can think of. And Jane has carried it off with huge flourish and no little talent. She's even released her grip on her dream in order to include Willem, so that the place actually now does feel like their home. For someone who's never built before, that's some class act.